Are you able to hear me?
Yes, yes, everyone.
So, continuing from where we left yesterday, so we were checking different properties. I told you that change log will get overflowed over a period of time, unnecessary, all the entries will be there. We can delete that to save space. That is part of housekeeping activity. So PSA deletion, every 1 week we have to delete, right? PSA deletion, change log deletion, these are all called as housekeeping activities that will be running separately. When loads are not running, we can run these housekeeping jobs or chains. Now, in a load one, in the first load, I have loaded 10 records. Okay, in a request one, 10 records. In request two, 20 records. So, forget about the values of the data. If I delete the request two, how many records will remain in the target?
Ten.
10, obviously. So why we are saying like that? The earlier request, whatever data is there, that is the 20 records data is gone when you delete that request. Likewise, you are having 101 20 kg it came. This was part of request 1. 101 30 kg it came. This was part of request 2. So the data was in active table, it was 101 20 kg. Then you have 101 20 kg and record mode N. Here it becomes 101, it overwrites it and it becomes 30 kg. 101 minus 20 101 30. Now my question is, after I loaded the second request, the data was overwritten and entries in the change log. If I delete the second request, what should be the value? Or if I delete second request, how many requests or what request should remain in the DSO?
Should be one, right?
Request one. But after loading second request, the data was 101 30 kg. So when I delete this second request, it should revert back to 101 20.
Right.
Okay, that is nothing but indirectly it is having only request one. So from where is it taking that information that earlier it was 20, so it has to revert back to 20? From the
Change log. Change log.
change log, correct, because it here it maintains the before image as well. So based on this, it understands, okay, my before image was 20, so I will revert back to that image. So this is called as rollback. I might have told you during theory session as well, rollback. So now one not 120, 101 30, 101 40, So if I delete third request, what should be the status?
30.
Just think about it. First, I have loaded this one. This I have loaded again. Next, last, I have loaded third request. If I am deleting third request, what should be the status?
The status meaning what's the word would be the value in DSO, right?
Yeah.
The second one.
Can I say previous request status it will be?
Yeah.
What was the final status after the previous request? It will be that.
Yeah.
Just in case I have three and I am trying to delete this second one. In that case, what should be the status?
40, right? The 40.
Think about it.
Or the previous status will goes with 1, right?
So
Will be what?
even if you are deleting this, it is not only rolling back request 2, it should also roll back request 3.
Oh, so you cannot just pick the request. It goes by sequence then.
It checks the previous status and whatever on top of that it will roll back.
Okay.
If I delete request 1,
It will roll back everything.
correct. So that's the concept we need to know. So you can see over here, topmost if I delete, it allows. And moreover, when I am deleting like this, I am deleting only from active table. Change log is not getting deleted. We have to specifically delete if you want. Now if I am deleting this one, so even this one should be rolled back. Let us see. After active, before activation, these request numbers will be the reference. After activation, this is the reference. So if I am deleting 205, searching for 206, this has also been activated. It has to be rolled back as well. So both of them are 205 and 207, both will be deleted. When I am deleting some data from a target, can I load data into it parallelly? Or will it cause any locking issue?
It should not, right?
It will cause a locking issue. Any object, if you are working on that, a lock will be set. So when another function you want to perform on that object, it will say that it's already locked by an operation. So while you are deleting, lock is set for deletion. Then you are loading at that same time, it will say lock set for deletion, cannot load. Imagine PSA DSO request 1, request K, request 2, it enters request. If suppose we have identified that user has reported that data is not correct, how do users report that data is not correct? On what basis they will say that data is not correct? Will they be using something else to compare?
Can you ask the question again? Sorry.
User is running reports regularly. Suddenly he will come back to us saying the data is not correct.
Oh, okay.
My question is, how can user say the data is not correct? Is he using something else to compare? Oh?
Yeah, he probably going in ECC and looking at, no?
Correct. So in ECC there will be certain simple reports.
Right.
Okay. So reconciling, that is called. So he will be is doing his business, he has sold something, or is in his department something got sold. He has an idea that he has sold 10 kgs or 10 kgs was sold. If the values are showing 20-30, obviously he would sense something is wrong. Then he would run the reports, he would reconcile, or he will go to the document and check. So there are certain reconciling methods for each area in source system.
Okay.
For finance you have separate reports, for header like that, for sales you have separate reports. So users, mostly they are from R3 background. So they would have used PW recently. So they are used to R3 reports. So always they check R3. R3 is the single point of truth data. The data will be correct in R3. So they are used to that. Likewise, when they find any abnormal data, they will reconcile. Then that is how they say that issue is there. So after that, we are not aware. We don't have a track of what all reconciling methods they are using for each area. So when user reports that I am having data is not correct, you would check back with him, kindly tell me how you are checking it in source system. So we will tell us that I am using so and so report, or I am using so and so T code. So then slowly you will get to know each area. Okay, this is how users will check, we will learn like that. So we will also do our analysis. So first you will check it in the source system. Then you check it in DSO. Okay, so then you compare, okay, where the issue is. like that you do the analysis. You split down the data, you do the analysis. You also ask the user, okay, you are saying this document is wrong. Is there any document which is showing correct data? So you have one bad record, you have one good record. So using the two records, you can do further analysis in PW and R3. So that's how you will come to a conclusion. Now let us say if I concluded that the issue is due to data which got loaded on 3rd. So on 3rd, some data was wrong and it was wrongly loaded to DSO as request 6. That is causing the issue. So how can I rectify this?
You roll back, right?
Yeah, I delete the request 6 from DSO. Okay. So this is one way. You go to the target. Imagine you are having like this. Okay. You can activate all of them at once or some of them together. Like for example, while activating, I cannot directly activate 17. The dependent should be activated. The prior in the queue should be activated. Let me do one more load. So I am activating it. So these two I am combining and activating. So both of them will be activated together. You can see 315, 316. After activation, the request ID is 319. That is, they are activated together. That is, both of the data, the information going to change log in a single request ID. This request ID is nothing but 319. Can go to technical characteristics. in this table. You will have this combination, request SID and request technical name. You can see 319 is nothing but this one itself. Now the other two you can activate. So while activating the other two, I will choose do not condense, so they will be not be activated together, individually activated. Can see these both activated as separate requests. Now coming back to our case, this is one scenario how it could have happened. Another scenario is both of them activated as a part of requestify. In first case I am activating individually, in second case this both requests I activated together. Now again same issue, user reported mismatch. We have done analysis, found out that on this fourth load there is an issue. So if I try to delete this fifth, will it also delete the data which was loaded as a part of request 3?
No.
I think both of them activated together, right?
Yeah.
So if I try to delete only request 5, I am clear that this is the causing issue, but since both of them activated with same ID, it will roll back even this one as well.
Yeah.
The data from this one as well. The data is activated together, so entire data is gone. In this case, if you see, if this was the case in the first one, individually each load is individual, I can delete that load. Now imagine if this is the second case, both different requests were activated together, even though I want to delete the topmost, searching for request 315, this has been activated with this request. So ideally, what do you suggest? Activating individually or together?
Individually?
Usually, yeah.
Yeah. So it all again depends on the frequency of the load. If daily I am having load multiple times,
many files are being loaded to the target. So what usually what happens is daily loads will happen. You load data to the DSO. Sometime in the afternoon or in the evening, they will be activated and then sent to the kube. So loading to DSO would be regular, frequent, but activating and sending to kube would be less frequent. So in that case, imagine 20 files have come to DSO. They have just loaded in the afternoon time when activation is running. If you activate 20 requests individually, it creates so many different request IDs. So in that case, we have to check the load frequency also. If daily one or two loads, you activate separately. If many loads are there, if you activate separately, that will cause performance issue. Many loads, you can activate together. So it is not a fixed solution. Depending on data frequency, data load frequency, we can choose a particular method of activation. Okay. If you want to delete entire data from DSO, you are deleting from here, that means you are deleting only from active table. If you want to delete from change log, you delete from here. If you want to delete entire data, just click on this. That is one way. Or on the DSO itself, you can do right click, delete it. This is also the same. So data from all tables will get deleted if you delete like this. This is in detail about different properties of DSO. Now let us see. In real world, what is the term we use for automating the loads? How are we automating the loads? Using what? Recollect? So, can you tell me steps to let us see?
So that's you do it.
Process change over here. Or if you type the T code also, RSPC, it takes you to here only. So here you have each area. If you put it into a separate component, it is better, like sales area chains, finance chains, like that. So if you are not putting it into any component, that will be under unassigned. So it's up to us whether we want to create a component or whether you want to put it under an assignment. So we can create a component. Info area PC component. Yeah, you were asking something, Navid.
Yeah, I was thinking that when you said how you schedule,
mm-hmm.
I thought was you talking about in DTP or info, you know, info package. But this is something different, right?
No, what I'm saying is how do you automate the schedule?
Oh, automate the schedule. Okay, okay.
So once I create a folder over here for arranging, I can create my chain, right click. So whenever I create, I need a starting time for the chain to start. That is called a start process or start variant. What does it say? Start process. You have to create a process variant. Okay, so what it is saying, how do you want the load? Is it a dependent load or an independent load? It is asking. In our case, what it is, does some other load finishes, then the DSO load should start, or is it independent?
Independent.
Okay, so dependent scenario also we can have, like whenever we are loading data, first master data should be loaded. So while creating transaction data, while creating master data, again within that attributes first, then hierarchy, attributes, text, and then hierarchies. So while creating the chain for attributes, that will be a independent, but for text it is dependent. Once attribute finishes, text. For hierarchy, again it is dependent. Once text finishes, it will finish. So for attributes, I should use direct scheduling. For text and hierarchy, I should use this one, indirect. Like this is, this says it is dependent. Okay, the earlier finishes, that will trigger. So if that is the case, you choose second option, else first one. So when it is independent, what is the timing for it?
So how independent does it is start? Only for attribute, Arvind?
Yeah, no, I'm just giving an example.
Okay.
To explain this dependency.
Okay.
Ideally, it is ideally attributes is independent. There may be cases like where only no attributes are there, only text load is there.
Okay.
So text would be independent in that case. For some objects or for some area, you don't have attributes, only text. So
okay. Yeah.
We can't take it as a thumb rule, but I've just given you a scenario to understand. Okay. So if it is independent, how does it begin? Does it begin immediately? or the date and time usually loads happen in the night time. It does happen in the morning time also, but usually it happens in night time. So when does it happen? So current time is 7:13. Okay, so you are saying that it will start at so and so time, and is it periodic? For the first time you are setting up the schedule, after that it should run accordingly. So if you want it to be a periodic, choose it. Periodic values, hourly, daily, weekly, like that.
Okay.
Select that. Any specific restrictions that on holidays and Sundays it should not run? You can keep over here. But if you want to say that on holidays and Sundays it should not run, that should know what are the working days. So a calendar IDs should be known. So according to your company, can choose the calendar ID as per the location. If it is in US, so that calendar will have all the days information. Based on that, it will fetch and it will run on the work days only. So that information you can see in SQL. Factory calendar. We want to see US. So according to them, these are the working days and other things. Number of work days, number of free days in 2014. What are the holidays? You can see. So like this, it is making use of this to schedule the job. This factory calendar information will be maintained in the R3 side. You have to update it regularly, not regularly, once in a while. It may be yearly, once. Well, you can update by doing like this. Right click, transfer global settings, factory calendar. Now it will rebuild all the tables from factory calendar related tables from ECC to BW. It will rebuild. In BW also same table will be there. Whatever table the factory calendar information is stored in ECC, similar table you will have in BW. But in BW you are not maintaining anything. You are fetching everything from ECC. So this is the table, decals. Many other tables are also there. Same table in ECC BW. It's getting updated. So I have given date and time. Now, users will, I told you about application server files, the different concept. Either user will send it to bases, they will upload to server, or they have an interface team which sends, they send to interface, interface will send to us, like that. We have scheduled the load as 727, let us say. By the time if the file is not arrived, what happens to the load?
You will not get loaded, right?
It will fail,
yeah.
Saying that file is not available. Now, if you have a monitoring team, they will monitor it, but when do, how do they know? They try to repeat the load, they try to fix it, but if they try immediately also, if the file is not there, it will not load, not
yes.
It will not be fixed. So giving a gap of half an hour, 1 hour, again they have to try and fix it. Okay, they will fix it fine. Now sometimes there will be special requirement, user will send the file early. Instead of regular time, they will send early and they will try to run the report. they will come back saying that I am running the report. I have sent you file before 1 hour only. I am running report. Why I am not seeing the data? You will tell him that whenever you have sent the file, but it is supposed to run at specific time. That's why data not yet loaded. You cannot see. So he will again complain, saying that sometimes you will tell that I am sending late. That's why data is not available. Sometimes you are saying that I am sending early, data is not available. Why are you depending on my time? Ensure that whenever I send, I get that data. So there should be another way. We have to design this instead of depending on time. So there should be a way such that if user posts a file, whenever he posts it, immediately the load should trigger. Whether he posts early or whether he posts the file late, it doesn't matter. So the moment the file is coming to the server, the load should start. So what you can do is define an event receiving file to server can be defined as an event. So once file received, event will trigger, hence chain will run. Leave all this headache of date and time. I will put after event. So first I create an event. Event will be some program logic. So we take help of Ababer to create event. Once event is created, you specify over here and you put it dependent on event. So it is an independent chain, but it is event driven chain, you can say. Event based chain. So this is how it, this is the ideal way. Likewise, some other things are there. A particular job will finish, then only another change should start. So you never know, job can finish in 1 hour or 40 minutes or 2 hours. You can't give any timing for that. So to be more accurate, what you can do, you can give the dependency of job, after job. So whatever that job you want, your chain is dependent on, you give it over here. Once it automatically, once it finishes, automatically the chain will trigger. So like this possibility is there for different scheduling things.
So job example would be like
yes.
Yeah, I mean, can you give a simple job example? Like what could a job be?
No, it will be functionally dependent. Functionally. Some job will be there which will run a load. Once that load is done, another load should begin.
Okay.
What happens is, in we are usually loading data from application tables, right? From R3.
Yeah.
So you have purchase order, EKKO, EKPO, like that, some application tables are there. So you can take an example. So what happens is, if you are getting from application table, no problem. Your data source, if it is fetching from application table, no problem. But in some scenarios, what happens is, they will run a job in R3 side to populate data to a custom table. So what that job will do is, some conditions will be there. Based on that, it will fetch the data from standard tables, EKKO, EKPO, for example, and then put it into a custom table.
Okay. So,
and your BW extractor is not defined on the standard tables. You are not going to use a standard extractor. You are going to use a custom extractor, generic extractor. So that is based on that table. So unless that table is populated, you don't have up-to-date data. Sometimes what happens, table will be deleted and loaded daily. Yes, every day they can delete the table in the and then reload it with, like, the custom table need not have entire data. Based on some conditions, they are maintaining that table. So unless the table is up to date, your BW load will not be perfect. So first an R3 job will run to populate the table. Once the job finishes, the table will be populated, then you can trigger a load in BW. So in that case, can I give that job as the dependent?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so that is one of the example.
So, and how it is related, the code needs to be written same as the events needs to be generated in this case?
It is automatic. It will trigger automatically. Once the job finishes, this will understand and it will fetch it.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Ideally, now I am putting as immediate. Save it. So, mine is an independent chain which starts immediately. That is defined by my start variant. So whenever you get like this, you choose the network flow. That is more flexible. You can later on change it to tree display over here, if you wish. I'll stop it with this. I have to move on to our next session.
Okay.
So, Arvind, if you don't mind, can you send me the note for yesterday as well? Try to cover over the weekend.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye.
Okay, guys. Thank you. Have a nice weekend.
Are you available over a weekend? Do you wish to have session or do you have it on Monday night only?
Let's do it Monday because I was planning on covering, like, you know, these three classes.
I'm traveling too, so this weekend is hard.
Okay, fine. Monday night we will meet again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.